Professor Dr. Jayapal Acharya is a former director, School of Life Sciences, and former professor and head, Department of Zoology, University of Madras. He has more than 40 years of teaching experience at the university level. He holds a PhD degree in marine science and has contributed extensively in the area of coastal zone management. He was also educated at the Duke Marine Laboratory, North Carolina, USA. He is the first Indian to receive, since 1920, the prestigious International Award from the Plymouth Marine Laboratory, UK, for the year 1991. He was invited to deliver keynote address in the first, second, third, and fourth world conferences in bioethics in Spain. He is active in promoting international bioethics by way of serving as the president of Asian Bioethics Association and as an associate editor in UBO's Journal of Asian and International Bioethics, Japan, and International Society of Bioethics, Spain. He is a co-editor of the Living Dictionary of Bioethics. He has presented and published more than 100 research papers. 38 research students have received the doctorate degree under his guidance.
Welcome to UGC lecture series on environmental science. In the course of different lectures, we have been thinking about ecology, ecosystem, and ecobalance and sustainable development. We also seen that human beings are need based, and we have many mega needs like water and land and earth. In this lecture, we are going to consider about one of our needs, the mega needs like water. And the topic of the lecture is going to be why it is not a renewable resource. So we have to go back. In this lecture, we will consider why water is not a renewable resource. We have to find a number of reasons for that. Then we are going to consider water, the difference between living and non-living resource. And also among that, we are going to consider the renewable and non-renewable resource. So, there is a common misconception about water. So, that has to be clarified. So, the main objective of this lecture is going to be that we should have the correct perspective of water and not wrong information on water. So, the contents of the lecture is projected as water is projected as a non-living resource. And that is very agreeable to everybody. But water is not a renewable resource. It is the best example for a recyclable resource. So, I am going to introduce a new category called recyclable resource. Finally, we will consider, can water be a commodity? You remember that the root word for ecology is oikos. And that word is also a root word for economics. And that root word also a root word for ecumenics, the humanity needs and their oneness in nature. So, the word commodity, common good, is an economic term. So, people have used the water as a commodity and made money out of that. How far is this justifiable, we will consider. So, I am going to concentrate on two types of typology. The word typology means that what types, what categories, what divisions of resources we can have. So, the old classification is that natural resource, then we have a renewable resource and non-renewable resource. Everybody is familiar with this classification, the renewable resource and non-renewable resource. Then we also have man-made resource, that money, currency, medicine and all services like sewage, drinking water, and most importantly, the education is a renewable man-made resource. So, I am including two other categories called the human resource and the human fertility as a resource, which we will not consider in this lecture. Human resource is very important that we manage the ecosystem wisely in a manner that is sustainable to everybody. So, to go through our syllabus, that we have one unit 2 is a natural resource. Then we have a unit 2 is a renewable and non-renewable resource, and under renewable resource, we have water resource and mineral resource. So, this is the older classification, and we have to find out the new classification. That so I am using the word, a system gets deteriorated, that means the system cannot maintain equibalance if it left to itself and without any intervention. Intervention is that we need to recycle water, we need to recharge the water, we need to take care of the water resources that we have. So, I am going to introduce four types of divisions. One is the natural resource, perpetual resource. Perpetual resource, you will see later, that is our sun. Then renewable resource, non-renewable resource, and recyclable resource. So, these are the four divisions that we have in our new classification. So, perpetual resource is our sun, and renewable resource, and non-renewable resource, and recyclable resources. So, the new typology, these two things we will consider under human ecology, but we will skip it. I am going to give you a brief introduction to some sacred texts. So, one of the sacred texts is, if I use the word Book of Job in the Bible. And this is, Book of Job is not a religious book, it is not attached to any religion. Our former president Radhakrishna said that Book of Job and others falling in the time of Abraham, in that time period there was no global religion, and no global religion formed, global religion was formed later. So, whatever message this book has got to say is for all humanity. So, in this book, that is very important, that I am not going to talk about any religion, but it is about the quality, quantity and the typology of water. So, in the Job, there are several correct scientific facts. One type is renewable resource. So, in this is found in the Book of Job, that about plants. It says, there is hope for a tree. If it is cut down, that it will sprout again, and that its tender roots, shoots will not cease. In verse 8, though its roots may grow old in earth and its stump may die at the ground, yet at the scent of water it will bud and bring forth branches like plants. So, this is a renewable resource. So, we harvest rice plants, but we plant one more seed, that rice plants that we harvested can be renewed. So, this is a renewable resource. So, that's we agree with the older classification, plants are renewable resources. But the point is, we consider about water, then chapter 38 verses 28 and 29, it has a question, has the rain a father, who has begotten the drops of dew, from which womb comes the ice? So, the usage of the word father and the begotten and the womb indicates that it needs to have a human resource, human being, and without father, a child cannot be produced. So, that means it is not a renewable resource. The water has no seed, water has no father. So, water is not a renewable resource. So, that is the ancient wisdom found in sacred text. So, this is what we have to emphasize, that in the minds of students and community members, that water is not a renewable resource. Once we lose water, that resource is gone. As I told you earlier, in Chennai city, there were at least four important rivers. One is the Kuvam river, called the, and then we call the Elumbu river or the North river, and Uttaravadini is the third river. And out of these two rivers, Uttaravadini is gone, and now then we have also the Adyar river. And the river's water, once it is gone, North river is gone, and so we cannot renew it. And you also remember that in the Chennai city, the number of lakes were there. The Nungambakkam area, it's a lake area, and all the lakes have been filled up, and the water has been lost, and we cannot renew it. So that's why we cannot renew water by man-made efforts, and it's not a renewable resource; it's a recyclable resource. So the word I have mentioned, that who can give birth to water? So, nobody can give birth to water. So, water is a natural resource, and it is not man-made, it can be never be produced by man. That is why in ancient Vedic literature, we find that water has been the yogna, they have done a lot of religious ceremonies to bring down water. So it is not in the purview of man's control. That's very important to understand. So he calls water, and also in the book of Amos, it says that the waters of the sea pour them out on the face of the earth, and the Lord is his name. So we have to understand that we cannot take the water from the sea and pour it on the land, but it is happen as naturally. That's why we say that water is not a renewable resource, and it needs to be out. It's not in the control of human beings. So now the typology of resource is that we have seen that the four typology. The perpetual resource is the sun. I'll show you the picture of the sun. We need sun all the time to keep the life going on the earth. Then renewable resource is plants and other things, and non-renewable resource is minerals and petrol. Petrol, you know that it's a fossil fuel, and once we use entire petrol, then it cannot be renewed. So the minerals also, we are using it in long number of activities in human life, and the rare earth minerals which we use in all computer based implements, gold, platinum and all other materials are used, and once we exhaust it, then that is gone. Similarly, the nuclear materials also is a non-renewable resource. Once we exploit all these resources, it cannot be renewed. Then the second category is man-made resources, that we need to have potable water. Potable water that is purified, water that is ready to consumption. And we know that no ecosystem in nature is in the state of ready-to-use state. It has to be made, perfected, purified, made into a perfect entity for human consumption. And water, pure water, natural water is not available. The pristine water is not available in nature, but any water that comes through river has to be purified. That's why we have in Kilpok the water work system where all the water is removed, bacteria and fungal and other microorganisms are removed and made potable for drinking. That's why I mentioned it. Water is a man-made service, is a potable water. And the type of resource that this we will consider in the human ecology group. So the general features of water is there. Is this you have to be very familiar with. Water is unevenly distributed in nature. Even in take our India, water is not available everywhere. In some places like Kerala and other places, in Kerala there are more than 40 rivers, and water is available everywhere. But if you go to Rajasthan and other areas, water is not available as we have it in South India. So, and in Ganges and Calcutta, water is available. So, one point we have to be very clear about it, the distribution of water is not even. So, some countries have more water like Switzerland, and some countries like Iran and other places, water is not available in plenty. And water is one of the most vital resources. Vital means that it is necessary for life. If you don't have water, then water is will be a limiting factor for life. And also we find that there's water should be balanced, a harvest of water must be there, and it should be recharged, and the water is life. If the water is not recharged, then water table will go down. There are a number of other ecological and geological factors are involved, and that we will consider at the end of this lecture. So now general features of water are this. Water is a finite resource, so it's not infinite resource. We have to be very careful. That's why we said, I told you earlier, that it is a given capital. The capital is given, capital is fixed, it is not infinite, it is finite in nature. That is to say, the amount of water in the biosphere is fixed, and it is not an infinite amount there. So, the same amount of water has to be recirculated and recycled. So, we will consider more about it in the next part of the lecture, and now we will have a small break. Welcome back to the lecture. We are considering about water, and we are considering about the typology of water. Typology means how we can categorize it, how we can give a name for it. Natural resources are generally two types, living and non-living. Fish is a living resource. Minerals and fossil fuels like petrol are non-living resources, and this can be further divided into two groups, renewable resource and non-renewable resource. Among the renewable resource, the best example is plants. Plants can be renewed. Once you cut a plant and if you leave the root, it will come back to life again. And plants have seeds. So if you take one seed out of the harvested plant seeds and plant it, then it will give forth more than what we have harvested. So it is a renewable resource. And usually we find that water is considered to be a renewable resource. But if you study carefully and analyze all the geophysical factors, water is not a renewable resource. It has to be preserved carefully and used judiciously so that water will be available for everybody. And you remember in the last lecture, in the previous lectures, we said sustainable development. Sustainable development is without affecting the needs of the future generation. The present generation must use the natural resources. That's one point. So the amount is limited, we cannot exploit it so that the amount get reduced. And also sustainable development is that the water quality must be same as what we have today. You should not leave polluted water to the next generation. So it is sustainable development. So in order to have a sustainable use of water, in order to have a sustainable development in ecosystem, we need to consider the reality of water, that water is not a renewable resource, it's a recyclable resource. And the second point I have mentioned that it's not an infinite resource. It's not available in large quantities, it's available in limited quantities. So we know that water exists in three forms. The first form is solid water, that is an ice. We found the North Pole and South Pole, and in mountain tops we have snow and ice is a solid form of water. And when the temperature goes up, the solid form of water becomes liquid form, and the liquid form is the most important resource for life. If you remember the space adventure to Mars, what cosmologists are looking is there a liquid water? And in Mars, we know that there are plenty of solid frozen water, but frozen water is not enough for sustaining life. Water should be in a liquid factor. And if it's not in a liquid factor, it will be a limiting factor. Limiting factor is that which controls and curtails the further development of use of water for humanity. Thirdly, water also exists in vapor form. So this is interchangeable. And if the water from the sea has to be poured down onto the land, water has to be evaporated. So that's why we see in the energy cycle, energy is a flow, that water is heated by the infrared rays. Infrared rays are called the heat rays, which heats up the water in the sea and brings the water down to the land. So this is a global cycle of water. So this is very important to see. And so we will consider liquid water. And as I said, this is our natural given capital. And it is a revolving fund. So you take some amount and you repay it. And that repay is called the recharging of the groundwater. So not only water is found in three states, water also distribution is found in three different areas. That I will come to that in a short time. So it's a revolving fund. It's a revolving fund. If it is not repaid back to the nature, then the amount will fall short, and we will not have enough water to circulate. So the circulation is called revolving fund. Revolving fund is you take one amount of fund from the capital, and you repay back. And if you don't repay, then the capital fund becomes less in number, less in amount. So we are not able to sustain that original amount of water for all human beings. So this is a picture of a sun. The sun is very essential for all forms of life, and the sun is essential to convert the three forms of water into liquid water, which will be useful for human beings. And if the sun energy is lost, then water will be all frozen into ice, and we will not be able to, any life in on earth, on the biosphere, will not have life. Life will come to a grinding halt. So sun's energy is very important. So now what's the difference between natural and artificial? So we find what happens in nature, what is present in nature is natural. That is the hand of God. Or if you feel like it is naturally is found, and it, no other external influence is necessary to maintain it. And what is made by man is the artificial, and water cannot be produced by human hands. Sometimes you might find that in the spacecraft, water can be produced by mixing hydrogen and oxygen, but it is very costly and it requires controlled conditions. But how quickly water is formed by plants? In the photosynthesis, water comes as a byproduct. And so water is plants are very essential in the recycling, and that we will consider at the end of this lecture. So the point I want to emphasize is there is no artificial water anywhere in the world. That we can convert sea water into potable water by reverse osmosis. That is, we are converting one resource into another resource, but it is not artificially produced. It is removing the salt and making the sea water less saline so that we can use it. And so we have to be, and then we depend upon rainwater. Rainwater is not artificial water, but rainwater can also be produced by climate seeding, cloud seeding. So silver can be used, but it is very costly. So any natural water is cheaper, and is available. Not only cheaper, it is free. Plants make it for us free. And so the water cycle, global cycle, has to be maintained. So, but you have to remember that water cannot be produced artificially. So, in terms of water, we need to have a long-term vision. So, here is a literature from Kettering, from a British poet. My interest is in the future because I am going to spend the rest of my life there. So, future is going to be very, very long and unending. So how long do you think water can come? And if you are not using very carefully and judiciously, then we will fall short of water, and there will be water wars in the world. So I'm going to talk about a vital natural resource. The one is water, air, land, and water is life. And the picture that you see is the power plant. In the produce power plant, power electricity, also we need water. The water, if you don't have water, then the entire cooling system will heat it up, the reactor will blow up. That's what happened in the Fukushima Japanese tragedy in March 2011. The nuclear power plant was technically all right, but the landslide, the earthquake cut off the water for cooling the reactor. So the reactor got hot and it blew up and caused a lot of radiation. So water is essential in every aspect of life, whether you live, whether you drink or bathe, or in industrial development, water is very, very essential. Sea water is also very essential. Most of the power plants are located around the plant, around the sea coast, wherever water is there, because water is needed to reduce the heat that is produced in the power plant situation. So, if you read the Constitution, we have a right to life. A right to life is a fundamental human right, that everybody in the universe, everybody in the earth have the right to life. And I told you that water is life. So, everybody, if you consider, if you have a right to life, then you also have a right to good quality water. So, right to life is a fundamental human right. So, if you are a human being, you have the right to live on this earth. And if water is the life, then therefore all must have the right to have easy access to clean water. So, this is the logic of this situation. Our Constitution guarantees that all must have access to clean water. So availability of water is one aspect, and access to clean water is another aspect. So as I said earlier, no natural system is found in a ready to use stage. It has to be purified, it has to be made potable, so that we have the access to clean water. So accessibility is a very important aspect that needs governmental regulation, governmental rules and infrastructure development. So that makes available water available to everybody in the city. So not only clean water is essential, and clean environment is also essential. And if you go to a village, we have a borewell, and the borewell takes water under the ground, or subsoil water, underground water. But if you use cow dung and other materials to wash the vessels and pour the water near the borewell pump, the same water is being pumped up. So that's why clean environment is very important. And in the case of cities, the Kilpak Water Works, the old pipes have been renewed and replaced. So the water quality is maintained, and so everybody has not only a clean water but clean environment to have it. To conclude this part of the lecture on water quality and water availability, I have to remind ourselves that the Constitution of India guarantees right to life as a fundamental human rights situation. And we also consider water is life. So logically, if you have the right to life, then one should also have right to clean water. So think of your own situation when people do not have the clean water and clean environment. And if they do not have the clean water and clean environment, purified water and drinkable water, then there's no point in assessing the in emphasizing the point that is a fundamental life the right to life is a fundamental human character. So now we will go into the summary of the lecture. That's we have seen that in this lecture the common understanding is water is a non renewable resource, common understanding. But if you consider very carefully, water is not a renewable resource like plants and other categories. Plants is the only category that we have the power to renew it and use it again and again, irrespective of the exploiting it. But water is a non-renewable resource, but it is a recyclable resource. So I will consider it little later what we mean by recyclable resource. And the second point is water is a finite resource. That is, unlike plants, it is not given in unlimited nature, but it is a limited nature, and I use the word revolving fund. So there is a fixed amount available to use. You borrow it, use it, and then repay it. So that's a revolving fund. Then liquid water is very important, and I said that water is a lifeline of any community. So if you not able to maintain water in a liquid condition, that means if human beings do not allow the sun to be functioning all through the life, then water will be frozen, and liquid water will be not available to the human life. So you remember that ours is the only biosphere which is found in the habitable zone from the sun, neither hot nor neither cold, not too hot nor too hot. It is a variable within the optimum temperature, where water can be in the three forms: in vaporized form, and in the solid form, and in the liquid form. Of all the three forms, the most important one is the liquid form, which is sustainable for life. Now we'll think of the questions. What do you think? Water is not a renewable resource. So we have been taught in the schools and other people that water is a renewable resource. But if you carefully consider, water is not renewable. So I am asking you a question: why do you think water is not a renewable resource? It's a recyclable resource. When you compare plants and animals and with water, what rules and regulations you should keep in mind to keep the quality and the accessibility of clean environment and clean water? So we emphasize two points: clean environment and clean water, and its availability and its accessibility. If water is not available in the clean condition, then accessibility is also a limiting factor. And consider role of education in creating the awareness about recycling water. So if you want to recycle water, what is the most important category? That most important category is trees. The trees do the water formation freely and very without any difficulty, without making any noise, and they do it silently, and water is produced indefinitely in a cycle. That's why it is a recyclable resource. And if you want to have liquid water, clean water, and recyclable water, then the role of plants is very, very important. We have to consider it very carefully. Keep plants, keep growing plants, so that water and plants are really interrelated. So human life will continue on this earth as long as water is available, as long as plants are available. Thank you very much.